थैंक यू प्रभु जी।
एनी ऑफ यू हैव एनी थॉट्स फ्रॉम दिस वर्स? Let's move on. O sinless Maharaj Parikshit, the order carriers of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Vishnu Dutas, saw that Ajamil was attempting to say something, and thus they suddenly disappeared from his presence. Interesting.
And I guess the last two lines actually are very indicative. Yes. The reason why they disappeared, the Vishnudutas made Ajamil aware of devotional service so that he might immediately become fit to return home back to Godhead. And then to increase his eagerness to glorify the Lord, they disappeared so that he would feel separation in their absence. In the mood of separation, glorification of the Lord is very intense. So this is amazing, right? That, you know, one would think, why did they just go? Like just when he was awakening or just when he was waking up, why did they just leave him? It's because so that he could actually experience this mood of intense separation, because the bhakti creeper is actually nourished by this mood of separation. And so the more, you know, we experience this sense of longing and the sense of, the more, you know, it deepens our appreciation, it deepens our desire to be with them. And that itself is actually the most purifying force in this world.
And I guess sometimes what will happen even in our devotional service, the verse before this, Prabhupada writes, Yesham tvantagatah papam jananam punya karmanam te dvanda mohanirmukta bhajante mam dridavrata. Persons who have acted piously in previous lives and in this life, whose sinful actions are completely eradicated and who are freed from the duality of delusion, engage themselves in my service with determination. So we may see that in our own spiritual life, our determination fluctuates many times. And it's basically because that our reactions from the previous activities, they have not been completely eradicated. But if we just continue without being discouraged by the fluctuation of our determination, very soon these sinful reactions from the past will be eradicated, and we'll find ourselves engaging in Krishna service with determination.
Any thoughts before we move on? So after hearing the discourses between the Yamadutas and the Vishnudutas, Ajamil could understand the religious principles that act under the three modes of material nature. These principles are mentioned in the three Vedas. He could also understand transcendental religious principles which are above the modes of material nature and which concern the relationship between the living being and the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Furthermore, Ajamil heard glorification of the name, fame, qualities, and pastimes of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He thus became a perfectly pure devotee. He could then remember his past sinful activities, which he greatly regretted having performed. So the next few verses are going to be about his regret. Let's read text 26.
Okay. Ajamil said, "Alas, being a servant of my senses, how degraded I have become. I fell down from my position as a duly qualified Brahmana and begot children in the womb of a prostitute."
He continues, he says, "Alas, all condemnation upon me. I acted so sinfully that I degraded my family tradition. Indeed, I gave up my chaste and beautiful young wife to have sexual intercourse with a fallen prostitute, accustomed to drinking wine. All condemnation upon me." So this is the mentality of one who is becoming a pure devotee. When one is elevated to the platform of devotional service by the grace of the Lord and the spiritual master, one first regrets his past sinful activities. This helps one advance in spiritual life. So the Vishnudutas had given Ajamil the chance to become a pure devotee. And the duty of a pure devotee is to regret his past sinful activities in illicit sex, intoxication, meat eating, and gambling. Not only should one give up his past bad habits, but he must also always regret his past sinful acts. This is the standard of pure devotion. It's a very, very significant point, because this act of contrition, this act of regret is very purifying and is actually, like Prabhupada saying, the standard of pure devotion. And we see that in the lives of all the great teachers, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, we were actually thinking of singing a few verses from his song. Go ahead, I'll draw it out.
My father and mother were old and had no other son or friend to look after them. Because I did not take care of them, they lived with great difficulty. Alas, like an abominable lower class man, I ungratefully left them in that condition. According to Vedic civilization, everyone has the responsibility for taking care of brahmanas, old men, women, children, and cows. This is the duty of everyone, especially an upper class person. Because of his association with a prostitute, Ajamil abandoned all his duties. Regretting this, Ajamil now considered himself quite fallen. So we can see that how Ajamil was in such a deplorable condition. But even such a person has a full opportunity to take to devotional service. And very quickly, as soon as he regretted and took to devotional service, he got the full mercy of Krishna. It is now clear that as a consequence of such activities, a sinful person like me must be thrown into hellish conditions meant for those who have broken religious principles and must there suffer extreme miseries.
So maybe we can, you know, sing this just a couple of stanzas and then we can read the... So this is...
Maybe I should bring it here.
Though. Yeah.
Just give me 1 second. I'll stop sharing this and share another bhajan. This is a bhajan written by Bhaktivinoda Thakur. It's called Danya. Danya means understanding our deplorable condition and calling out to Krishna for help. This is what Ajamil is doing.
Samsare asiya te nana idavetha
tumara charane asiya chiyame
vivo dukhera katha.
You guys can also repeat.
Bhuliya tumare samsare asiya e nana vidavetha
tum charane asiya
chiyame boli bodu kriya.
I forsook you, O Lord, and came to this world of pain and sorrow. Now I submit my tale of woe at your lotus feet. While still in the unbearable fetters of my mother's womb, I saw you before me. You revealed yourself, but briefly, and then abandoned this poor servant of yours.
Janani jathare chilamaja khano nishama bandhana paashe. Ek baar prabhu dekha diya more vanchile dina daase
पंछीले नादाचे अनिया तुम्हारे संसारे
While still in the unbearable fetters of my mother's womb, I saw you before me, you reveal yourself, but briefly, and then abandoned this poor servant of yours. At that moment, I swore to worship you after taking birth, but birth came, and with it, the network of worldly illusion, which robbed me of all good sense. Number three. We'll sing it next time. We'll finish the remaining song next time.
So these are very beautiful songs by Bhaktivinoda Thakur, which show the mood of a person, a devotee, who's just waking up from this dream, right? Because as soon as we start waking up from this dream, we realize, like, oh my goodness, what a crazy dream. And all the different, we become aware. Most of the times in the material world, people are actually not even aware of their own internal state. And if you just go around and just ask people, most people have a very strong sense that actually they are very fair people, that they are very good people, that they actually never hurt anyone, and so on and so forth. That's conditioned life, where we are completely in a state of forgetfulness and a state of unconsciousness. And we are not even aware that we might have some faults. And one of the things that happens, and this might happen, I mean, I think it's happened to so many of us, is that once you start the process of bhakti, you start thinking, I've become actually a worse person. Or, is it that I'm becoming a really, I used to be a much nicer person before, but actually that's not a fact. What's happening is that we're becoming aware of all our, desires. We're becoming aware of all our shortcomings. And so in the beginning, it's a little bit of a shock to the system. But the great devotees, they're actually, they're not troubled by it because they see, and then later in the later songs, this is the section on Danya or humility. Bhaktivinoda Thakur then says that seeing me in this condition, my spiritual master came and rescued me. So that's from that, it's from that womb of feeling the sense of inadequacy that you become very grateful.
Yeah, this Danya, this contrition is the foundation that allows us to go into this Danya. Otherwise, we feel that we are all powerful and I do not need Krishna. And also we feel that I'm all perfect and therefore there is no room for me to progress anymore. So this contrition is always good that Krishna, that I don't have any interest in your holy name. This is what Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says in the Sikshashtakam, in the second verse, that Durdeva Midrisham Iha Jani Nanuraga. This is a great misfortune that Krishna, you are present fully in your names, and I don't have any interest in you. When I'm chanting your names, my mind is just going here and there and thinking of million other things, but I'm not thinking of you. I'm not interested in you. This is the greatest misfortune. And this is all because of that we think that I'm good. I have other bigger problems to solve than this problem of birth, death, and old age and disease.
Also, we think that, that actually, my life was not so impious. That I was always a very pious person and that I was such a good person. And that's the reason why I received the seed of bhakti. So that also can become a kind of arrogance or pride within us. And so wherever there is pride, they cannot be bhakti. They're just polar opposites. And so this mood of danya or humility allows us to become the receiver that Sachinandan Maharaj was talking about earlier, to not be in the mood, or later he talks about that, to not be in the mood of an achiever, but to be in the mood of a receiver. So maybe we pause here because we've been talking for such a long time. We'll stop sharing. Hear from you all. What are your thoughts? Anything that you heard that you want to reflect back, because that way we can keep this.
Tapas Prabhu, any thoughts from you?
Prabhuji, I really, it
what resonated a lot with me is what Mataji said, is when you take those baby steps in spiritual progress, you start feeling that you are the worst person. I mean, I have felt that a lot of time. I keep feeling that all the time. I don't know it's good or bad, but I suddenly feel that, oh my God, how bad am I? How bad a person am I? That sometimes, it kind of joins to the earlier comment that you had made that, divided soul kind of stuff, right? So one part of the, you're telling that, no, you're good. The other part is saying, no, you're not making enough progress. So, I deal with it with a dilemma all the time, actually.
Yeah. And it's, it allows us sometimes, there might be some thoughts on desires that spring up and you think, where did that come from? Mm. How could I think like that? So, it's because we are becoming aware. They've always been there, but we are bahirmukhi, or we are always looking outwards. Mm. We're looking at others. We're looking at how wrong they are. And so we don't ever see inside our own heart what's really going on. But as we start practicing this process of bhakti, then we start becoming aware of ourselves. And where we are, and that allows us to take the next step and actually become free from unnecessary thoughts and desires. Thank you.
At the same time, when we feel that remorse, we should also feel hopeful and grateful to Krishna, because it may happen that if we beat ourselves too much, then the determination and enthusiasm for devotional service may not fully take off, because I'm such a bad person. I'm not good for devotional service. I'll never be good enough for Krishna, and I can never do this. So that's kind of a mind again trying to bring us away from devotional service. So while this contrition is there, we can see from Ajamil's example that he didn't just like immerse himself in that contrition and I'm good for nothing kind of a guy and let me just leave this. But he actually, with great determination, he took up devotional service with great enthusiasm. So this contrition has to be balanced with great hope and great enthusiasm. Yes, I have done some bad activities, but this is just my body and mind, and I can give it up with determination, with Krishna's help. I can give it up. So there's a great hope there.
That's called Asha Bandha, right?
Yeah.
That in spite of everything, there is still this hope within my heart, hoping against hope that, yes, of course, and Bhaktivinoda Thakur actually continues in his prayers. He says that you have actually delivered Jagai and Madhai, so there is this great hope. So yeah, it's very, very nice point. It has to be balanced. Anybody else? Let's see.
Tarini Ganga, any thoughts from you?
Yeah, Prabhu, I really like the discussion and I like the last part that Vidarbha was saying, that should not be bahir mukhi and should look inside than outside. And I was thinking that it can only happen by bhakti yoga, because otherwise no other way can actually make that turn. It can only happen through this process, through this path. So this is what I was
saying. Thank you. Yeah, we come face to face with ourselves. And sometimes we don't really like what we see. But just by hanging out with Krishna, we take on those qualities. So, Bhakti Lata, any thoughts from you? Anshulanchita, Anubhav.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Yes.
So, I think all those points, what Prabhuji also said, first is you first start introspecting yourself. You see other devotees and you see, oh my God, no, I mean, we can't do this. We are nowhere close to them. Not even spiritually, by day-to-day activities, the things which we do, not just do, the thing which we think, how we think, what we follow, what we don't follow, what we, like every second of our day is like opposite of what we should do. So it's you see lot of bad things in yourself, and then there were a lot of points. I mean, I think it's 1 year only, and there were lot of times we said, okay, we can't do this. We are too bad for this. It's not for, because it cannot. And then I think we are understanding little by little now that how important that Sangha and the association is, because anytime we had that thought, we either talk about it to some devotees, or by God's grace, by Krishna's mercy, we hear something in our in sessions. So I think we experienced a lot, and we're still experiencing it like day to day and minute by minute.
And it's like clarity of thoughts that are coming up with each and every session. You hear, understand new things, and probably the things that we used to do earlier, now we are not doing in that way. It's like clear thinking, and I'm not getting the exact word. I think purify, it's, yeah, actually. Purify. It's the purity which is coming within us.
Plus the intent behind the scene, behind the activities also has changed. The intent of getting something out of it is getting less and less, but it's a long way to go.
Wow, that's so nice.
Now, that's a very good point you made, that sometimes when we look at, this happens to all of us, when we look at very advanced devotees, and when we read in the Bhagavatam, we see great devotees like Prahlad and Dhruva, and sometimes you feel that I can never get to their level. I'll never be good enough to get to that level. And that is actually just a trick by the mind to keep us from going forward. We are all fully capable of reaching any height in devotional service. And no matter who we are, no matter how low we start from, and this is why this Ajamila story is very instructive, that he started from like pit bottom. I mean, when he was rescued by the Vishnudutas, he was at the pit bottom of his life. And from that point to very quickly achieve Vaikuntha is very, very instructive. So Krishna is so merciful that no matter who we are, he gives us full facility, and we are fully qualified to achieve any highest level that we read about or hear or see in other devotees. So one should never think that I'm not good enough or I will never reach that level.
In fact, you know, it's amazing that even though at some level we look at some of these great devotees, mm-hmm. right? And we go, oh my God. But then on the other hand, like lately we've been hearing this lecture on Bilva Mangal Thakur.
Mm.
And his life, you know, his past was just, he was completely, even though he also grew up in a Brahminical family, but he got it very attached to this prostitute, Chintamani. And, you know, when his father passed away, he came and he attended the funeral rites. And then as soon as it was not, the wood was still warm, he just ran because he wanted to be with her.
Mm.
And then he crossed this raging river. And he thought that, you know, this was a boat, but it was actually a corpse.
Mm.
And anyways, you know, went on and, you know, I went to Chintamani's house, and then Chintamani, you know, she actually, you know, Krishna spoke through her, and basically she chastised him and said, you know, you're just attached to this body, you know, and if you were attached to the Supreme Lord, you would be liberated by now.
Mm.
So that hits him, it pierces his heart, and then he leaves. But even after leaving, he still again gets attracted to the wife of a merchant.
Mm.
And he follows her, and then but then he feels like such a deep sense of remorse within his heart, like what am I doing? And so of course then Bilva Mangal Thakur, he pokes his eyes, and then, but you know, the point is that from that later, you know, Krishna actually would sit, when he would write his Krishna Karnamrit, Krishna would actually sit there and would just sit and listen to his poetry and his writing. And so it's just like, it's amazing, right? That, you know, so I guess the point is that every sinner has a future and every saint has a past.
Mm.
And so the past doesn't disqualify us. And there is so much for us to be hopeful because the process is so powerful and the mercy is so powerful.
Yeah, not that we want to become on the same level as these great devotees, because we may never be. And that's not important for Krishna. For Krishna, what is important is that we are always humble and following in the footsteps of these great devotees. That's what we desire. And that is good enough. That is good enough. If you just keep following in the footsteps of the great devotees, you get the full benefit of their devotional service.
I think I was also reading, I think this is by Ramanujacharya. I'm not sure, maybe Bhaktilata would be able to, but there's this very beautiful idea that, you know, when a lion leaps over a mountain, then the little fleas that are attached to the body of the lion, they also jump over that mountain.
Mm.
So in the same way, we might be just so small and insignificant and so faulty, but if you simply just latch on, just cling on to these mighty acharyas, you know, who can jump over huge mountains, then by their mercy, we can also cross over.
I think, Prabhuji, I think one thing Mataji had said a few classes back was very uplifting. I think it was a quote from Vaisheshika Prabhu, what you have basically said, that we might be, we are much closer than we think. That was really uplifting. You know, I used to always beat myself up. Then in that specific quote, it stayed in my mind. Whenever I feel down, I said, no, man, I'm really made some progress. You know, let me not look back.
I think there's another thing that Bhakti Lata had shared, which is on similar lines, which also, you know, really struck a chord with me. Mm. She was saying that when people are, there is some proverb where when they're making this yogurt, when they're churning this yogurt, then right at that point, when the yogurt is just, the butter is just about to like surface up, the person gets frustrated and discouraged and says, I can't do it, you know, and just, you know, breaks the pot or just, you know, and it's like right there. So it's the same thing for us. We are right there.
Yeah, I mean, this is a trick of when you start feeling that I can't do it, then that means you're very close to doing it. So at that point, we should not give up because the Maya is telling us that, oh, give it up, because you're just about to get there.
Mikunja, any thoughts, or we can continue maybe reading?
Yeah. Hare Krishna. Yeah, I really like your point that when you said that this process is actually makes you antarmukhi. And I was, when I started chanting in the beginning, I could see that I was chanting and my chanting was effortless. So as you were saying that, you know, all these devotees, they are like Vishnu Duta. So they, I don't know how, but it seems like they stand on both side of your eyes, and then, you know, your senses are kind of controlled and tamed and you're able to chant. But as you go along, I think the devotees also, push you a little forward to make you strong. So those hands, it feels like they're moving away, though they are there, but it seems like they're moving away and the path suddenly seems difficult. So what should one person do at that time? It's very easy because I have seen that it's like very nature to give up very easily.
Yeah, I mean, staying strong means staying close to the sound vibration as all of you are doing, and putting our energy in chanting the names. I think the process is very simple. Whenever you feel that you're not feeling strong, then put some energy into chanting. Just call out to Krishna. Just cry out to him during your chanting. And just take shelter of the holy, the sound vibration. Listening to lectures or listening to Prabhupada's lectures or whatever appeals to your heart. Just the remedy is the sound. Mm. Remedy is the sound. And the devotees are always there. Discussing your inner thoughts with devotees, that always gives strength. Expressing your heart.
Yeah, it's actually a process of maturation of a devotee from Vapu to Vani. That is the process of maturation. And in fact, you can actually test the authenticity and the integrity of a devotee by how they can hold on to the Vani. So when Prabhupada was on the planet, there were many people who were part of the community and they were part of the process, but when Prabhupada physically left, then they also left. So that is a sign of weakness, essentially. So we don't, as we go along in our Krishna consciousness, to the extent that we can hold on tight to the Vani, and the Vani is eternal, and the Vani is not dependent on any physical limitation. To that extent, we will actually stay as strong devotees through ups and downs. Mm. And we see that even with Prabhupada's disciples, there were many of Prabhupada's disciples who received very, very close physical association. But that close physical association did not necessarily translate into complete dedication. Mm. And then there were many others who actually just received, maybe they even got initiated by mail, or they just maybe had one or two brief meetings. Prabhupada himself had very little association, physical association with his spiritual master. So this is actually the power of this process, is that it's not dependent on just mere physical presence. And we see that even in Chaitanya Charitamrita, that there was this devotee who was walking around traveling with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, but he got caught up by the Bhattaharis, And so, just example over example, that it's not dependent just on physical association, even though that's really nice. It's really dependent on our being able to latch on to the Vani. Mm. So as long as we are doing that, then the protection is complete. There is absolutely no gap, that can take us away from the physical, in fact, one could be in physical association and yet be dragged away.
Mm.
But one cannot be dragged away if one is in the Vani association.
Mm.
So I don't know if that helps, Nikunja.
Thank you. It helps. Thank you.
Yeah. Was this a dream I saw, or was it reality? I saw fearsome men with ropes in their hands coming to arrest me and drag me away. Where have they gone? And where have those four liberated and very beautiful persons gone who released me from arrest and saved me from being dragged down to the hellish regions? This, when I'm reading this, it's reminding me of Narottam Das Thakur's beautiful bhajan.
Mm.
Karuna prachur. So it says that, you know, where are those people? Where is you know, Rupa Goswami? Where is Sanatan Goswami? Where have they gone? And then the last verse, it says that I'll beat my head against the wall and enter into a fire, you know, without their association. So this mood of longing, you know, he's actually remembering those four beautiful people and where they have gone.
Mm.
And so this Prabhupada saying that that mood of separation actually deepens bhakti.
I am certainly most abominable and unfortunate to have merged in an ocean of sinful activities. But nevertheless, because of my previous spiritual activities, I could see those four exalted personalities who came to rescue me. Now I feel exceedingly happy because of their visit.
Mm.
Can read this purport.
Yeah.
As stated in Chaitanya Charitamrita 22:54, Sadhu Sangha, Sadhu Sangha, Sarva Shastra Koi, Lava Matra Sadhu Sange Sarva Siddhi Hoy. Association with devotees is recommended by all the Shastras because by even a moment of such association, one can receive the seed of all perfection. In the beginning of his life, Ajamil was certainly very pure and he associated with devotees and brahmanas. Because of that pious activity, even though he was fallen, he was inspired to name his son Narayan. Certainly this was due to good counsel given from within by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. As the Lord says in Bhagavad Gita 15:15, Sarvasya Chaham Hridi Sannivishto Matta Smritir Jnanam Apohanam Cha. I am seated in everyone's heart and from me come remembrance, knowledge and forgetfulness. The Lord who is situated in everyone's heart is so kind that if one has ever rendered service to him, the Lord never forgets him. Thus the Lord from within gave Ajamil the opportunity to name his youngest son Narayan, so that in affection he would constantly call Narayan Narayan. And thus be saved from the most fearful and dangerous condition at the time of his death. Such is the mercy of Krishna. Guru Krishna Prasade Pai Bhakti Lata Bij. By the mercy of the Guru and Krishna, one receives the seed of bhakti. This association saves a devotee from the greatest fear. In our Krishna consciousness movement, we therefore change a devotee's name to a form that reminds him of Vishnu. If at the time of death, the devotee can remember his own name, such as Krishna Das or Govinda Das, he can be saved from the greatest danger. Therefore, the change of names at the time of initiation is essential. The Krishna consciousness movement is so meticulous that it gives one a good opportunity to remember Krishna somehow or other.
You want to speak on
that? Oh. Yeah, so this verse Prabhupada brings out that the power of association with devotees, even for a moment, lava means even a fraction of a second. And this association, through that association, then the seed of bhakti is deposited in the heart. And when we hear, like there's so many stories where people saw Prabhupada for a second, or they heard him speak for a second, and that association was so powerful that they felt that there was something very special there. And then they sought it out and then they became devotees. So Krishna is so attractive. And Krishna through the heart of a devotee becomes even more attractive because a devotee's heart is filled with this love and faith for Krishna. And when somebody sees that, it's like seeing Krishna like fully decorated on a throne. And that's how the heart of a pure devotee is. And therefore, from the heart of a pure devotee, Krishna is even more eager to go and sit in the heart of somebody else. And because of the devotee's compassion and mercy, Krishna becomes easily available. Otherwise, like sometimes, like when there is a scarcity of grains or something, during famine, then it's very hard to find grains, right? And people are really struggling. But then the government will suddenly open a special shop to provide everybody with these grains at a very reduced cost. And then it becomes very easy, or the government will drop these supplies from the helicopters or the airplanes in these flood hit areas. And then the supplies become easily available. So similarly, Krishna is very, very difficult to achieve. But with this association of devotees, he becomes very easily available.
Were it not for my past devotional service, how could I, a most unclean keeper, prostitute, have gotten an opportunity to chant the holy name of Vaikunthapati when I was just ready to die? Certainly, it could not have been possible. Ajamil continued, I am a shameless cheater who has killed his Brahminical culture. Indeed, I am sin personified. Where am I in comparison to the all auspicious chanting of the holy name of Lord Narayan? I'm such a sinful person, but since I have now gotten this opportunity, I must completely control my mind, life, and senses, and always engage in devotional service so that I may not again fall into the deep darkness and ignorance of material life. So purport, every one of us should have this determination. We have been elevated to an exalted position by the mercy of Krishna and the spiritual master. And if you remember that this is a great opportunity and pray to Krishna that we will not fall again, our lives will be successful. So this is actually, again, a very interesting and very important section indicates that this kind of contrition is not a self-absorption.
Mm.
It is not just another form of narcissism, right? Because it can be, you know, like I could just continuously just like say, oh, I'm so fallen and I'm such a terrible person. I cannot do anything and I'm incapable. And we can just sort of like, just kind of enter into this space, which is actually self-defeating. Rather, what we're seeing in this example of Ajamil is that even though he acknowledges and he understands that he has actually made a big mistake, but he's not dwelling there, you know, rather.
Yeah, and sometimes it may happen that in this scenario, Ajamil realizes that he made so many mistakes, but it may also happen that some external situation may happen in our life. Like our life may be completely turned upside down by some external situation or somebody in our life really making our life really miserable or whatever. And in that situation also, sometimes it may seem that, okay, I'm not good for anything. I'm like totally useless person and therefore I don't have any hope. But in that situation, if you turn towards Krishna and then with enthusiasm take shelter of devotees and turn towards Krishna, then that opportunity actually becomes a great doorway to extreme advancement in a short period of time.
I think the next two verses also depicts his determination. So maybe we can read that and then we can discuss. Because of identifying oneself with the body, one is subjected to desires for sense gratification and thus one engages in many different types of pious and impious action. This is what constitutes material bondage. Now I shall disentangle myself from my material bondage, which has been caused by the Supreme Personality of Godhead's illusory energy in the form of a woman. Being a most fallen soul, I was victimized by the illusory energy and have become like a dancing dog led around by a woman's hand. Now I shall give up all lusty desires and free myself from this illusion. I shall become a merciful, well-wishing friend to all living entities and always absorb myself in Krishna consciousness.
Amrita, would you like to read?
Yes, sure. Simply because I chanted the holy name of the Lord in the association of devotees, my heart is now becoming purified. Therefore, I shall not fall victim again to the false lures of material sense gratification. Now that I have become fixed in the absolute truth, henceforward, I shall not identify myself with the body. I shall give up false conceptions of I and mine and fix my mind on the lotus feet of Krishna. Open. How a living entity becomes a victim of the material condition is lucidly explained in this verse. The beginning is to misidentify the body as oneself. Therefore, Bhagavad Gita begins with the spiritual instruction that one is not the body, but is within the body. This consciousness can be possible only if one chants the holy name of Krishna, the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, and always keeps oneself in the association of devotees. This is the secret of success. Therefore, we stress that one should chant the holy name of the Lord and keep oneself free from the contaminations of this material world, especially the contaminations of lusty desires of illicit sex, meat eating, intoxication, and gambling. With determination, one should vow to follow these principles and thus be saved from the miserable condition of material existence. The first necessity is to become free from the bodily concept of life.
We can, maybe you can reflect, Amrita, anything that maybe you would like to reflect from this section here?
I think, you know, the determination and his prayer to Krishna to, you know, to not let him fall again is reflected pretty much in this, you know, in what he's saying. He doesn't want to go back. He wants to, you know, he wants to move forward in his bhakti, and, you know, that is what he's praying for.
Hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And that determination is actually really important. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, without determination, it's very difficult to actually practice Krishna consciousness or any spiritual process, because the mind is so powerful and the distractions are too many. So one has to become really determined to keep this stay in the process.
Sometimes the Lord's Maya seems way more powerful than the Lord, like, because when such great devotees fall for temptations, you know, like you don't expect them to fall, but it happens to them, and we are nowhere in front of them. So like, even though the Lord is powerful, the Maya sometimes takes over. And it can happen to anyone.
Very good point. The Maya, when these great devotees, they go through any fall down or whatever, it's not the Krishna's Maya Shakti, but it's Krishna's Yoga Maya Shakti, because these devotees are always under the protection of the Lord. And even if these great devotees sometimes seem to fall down, they're actually not falling down. They are just... even through that fall down, they become much closer to the Lord, and the Lord uses them to show an example for the rest of the world that how he protects his devotees, and then they never fall down. So Krishna's Maya is powerful, but it's definitely not more powerful than the Lord. And if you just stick to Krishna's lotus feet, and it may happen to us that even we show determination and then we fall down, and we show determination, we fall down, we show determination, we may fall down. After a few tries, then we feel, okay, this is too much. This whole thing is too much. And then let me just... So, but the process of devotional service does not become weakened just because we have fallen down. There's no fault in the process, and we should have full confidence that I will always succeed. And that is the guarantee of this process, that despite falling down a million times, we can still succeed to the full perfection.
Actually, the entire Bhagavatam is filled up with stories of fall downs. Mm. And it's amazing, you know, like you see, you know, whether it's Vritasura, whether it's Bharat Maharaj, or even now we're reading about Ajamil, right, that mistakes. Mm. And yet those mistakes are not permanent. You know, those mistakes simply become an impetus for them to even go deeper. Mm. So that's why in the Srimad Bhagavatam, you just described that on the path of bhakti, even if you close both your eyes and you just run, there's no danger of a fall down. So of course, we should be careful, and we should be very diligent in the execution of our process of bhakti, but we should also not be overly anxious. Mm-hmm. Rather, we should have that confidence. And that's utsaha nishchaya dhairyat. So utsaha means great enthusiasm. And nishchaya means determination, but nishchaya also means confidence, right? So both things are required.
Amritwani, Vishal, any thoughts from you?
So maybe we can, we won't read any more. So, I don't know, Tarun Kumar, Prabhu, Neel Kama, Anubhav, Shringar and Pavan Sarovar, if you have any thoughts. Sapna.
Tarunji, go ahead. Love to hear from you.
Muted. Nothing. I'm just trying to absorb these things. And as Tapas Prabhu said initially on, and Mata also said, that as we go in process of our bhakti, we really understand that how bad we are also. So those realizations has comes, keep coming to us as we progress in our path of in mark of bhakti. So I think we need to become more and more into our devotions. Sometimes I get confused whether we are what we have been doing so far in our life. And as we were discussing this morning, that we really woke up from our you know, dream and realize that we are in a, not in the world that we were thinking that we are supposed to, we were dwelling into.
Yeah, very nice. It is. It is. You know. You know. When you have this, like, oh my goodness, what was I doing?
Mm.
Whole life, and it's very nice. All right. Anybody else, and then we'll stop.
I just wanted to reflect back on a few points that we discussed today. That in the path of bhakti, you know, it's important to have a quality of submission and, you know, have a mode of gratitude. The second point we discussed, we also talked about, you know, the association of devotees and how, you know, it helps us elevate ourselves. Also, the mode of separation is something that we are bound to experience as, you know, we follow this path, and we're also bound to feel, you know, regrets of past acts that, you know, we've been through. And just to move forward, it's important to have determination and, you know, constantly praying to Krishna to not, you know, let us fall down.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Can you maybe share this?
Yeah.
Maybe this, you know, this is a service that actually would be so helpful because there are some people who are not here. So maybe if you want to just like create the summary and maybe
put it on the WhatsApp
group, you know?
Okay, sure. Yeah, I'll do that.
Something you can do, continue. This is amazing. This is so wonderful. All right. So thank you.
See you
also
on Monday evening.
Today is what? No, we're going to do our chanting.
For chanting, we'll see you. Class, we'll see you Monday.
Continue the chanting. And I think Daryl and Ashley, maybe they don't know that we are doing these classes. So maybe we'll reach out. And if you, Tarini, if you want to reach out, Eric and Daryl, Ashley, I think they probably are not aware. All right. Thank you.
So on Monday also is going to be 8 to 9?
Same time.
Yeah, we'll keep the same time.
We'll chant
at 7:30 and then class will be.
Yeah, on Mondays, on weekdays, I have to leave by 8:45, so just one.
That's okay. We are starting our chanting at 7:30.
Hare Krishna.
Have a wonderful day.
You too, Prabhu.